Good morning and welcome. We gather this morning, albeit virtually, as people of faith, people who believe that God is with us every moment. And so we gather to give thanks and praise to God and to pray. There are many people to pray for in our country and in our world and in our community. The bulletin for this service can be found on our website on the worship page. If you're using the Book of Common Prayer, the service begins on page 355 in the prayer book. I invite you to participate fully by praying the responses and the prayers and singing along. Even if we are physically separated, we are spiritually connected, and we can rest assured that God is with us. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world. Evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
First reading is from Genesis.
John, can you do it from the lectern?
Sure.
The mic. Thank you.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
from the letter of Paul to the Romans. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of us all, of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. And that is the wrong gospel. Excuse me. It's still from the Gospel of John. There was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in God and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior. Now, I know what some of you are thinking right at this moment. Not that I started with the wrong gospel, started reading the wrong gospel, but that was the wrong gospel for this fourth Sunday of Lent. You're thinking, those are the wrong scripture readings. The gospel for this fourth Sunday of Lent is supposed to be the story of the blind man, and you just read the story of Nicodemus after starting with the story of the woman at the well. Please let me explain. 2 weeks ago, we had a youth-led service, and we decided to use the story of the blind man for that service. And so we switched to doing Nicodemus this Sunday. I'm sorry. I know it is yet another disruption. So many disruptions. Schools and churches and restaurants shut down, working from home, trips canceled. Those are inconveniences. But some are facing lost jobs, illness with a lack of treatment, the death of a loved one, unsafe working conditions in healthcare facilities. Huge, life-changing disruptions. disruptions small and large all around us. Nicodemus, in the gospel that you just heard, had witnessed Jesus disrupting things so that something new might emerge. In John's gospel, two things happen prior to this encounter that Nicodemus has with Jesus. First, Jesus changes water into wine at a wedding feast in Cana. And then Jesus overturns the money changers' tables in the temple. Jesus disrupts things. He disrupts the purity code and the temple system. The water that Jesus turned into wine at Cana was meant for people to wash. If you wash in the proper way, then you will be pure and holy. The tables Jesus overturns in the temple were meant for people to pay to be able to offer ritual sacrifice. If you offer proper sacrifice, then God will hear your prayers. It's conditional. It's a conditional if-then system. Nicodemus, a Pharisee and a leader of the Jews, was fully immersed in this if-then system. If you break the law, then God will punish you. And Jesus turns his world upside down. Water for washing turned into wine. Wine, a symbol of God's grace and blessing and a foretaste of heaven. Turning the temple system upside down, toppling the money changers, disrupting things in order to bring about something new. Unconditional love. That famous line, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that God gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Humanity's relationship with God is not conditional. It's not if, then. It's unconditional. God loves, God gives. That's the new equation. God loves, God gives new life, life in the Spirit. Grace, God's free gift. Not works, not washing and temple sacrifice, but grace. A share in Christ's once and for all sacrifice of love. The ultimate act of love. Nicodemus, having witnessed Jesus' disruption of a system that Nicodemus was fully immersed in, comes seeking the new thing, the new life that Christ came to bring, life in the Spirit. Disruptions help to usher in something new. Disruptions open space to allow new things, new opportunities and patterns to emerge. Disruptions allow new life to come forth. The ground needs to be disrupted, needs to be tilled and broken open to receive the seeds of new life. The shell of the egg needs to crack and break in order for that new life to spring forth. Perhaps the disruptions we face in our lives now will allow something new to be born or reborn. new patterns and priorities. Instead of calling this social distancing, let's call it physical distancing. Because we need social connections now more than ever. The things that we've planned and organized are now canceled and postponed. So we need to find new ways of being together and connecting with one another. You might have seen that in Italy, people come out on their porches and balconies at 6 o'clock every evening to clap, to thank healthcare workers and first responders, and then they sing. We need to sing. And I just heard that a neighborhood in Minneapolis is doing this same thing. On my afternoon jogs, I see people out on their front porches. They wave and shout, "Hello." Maybe this will move us from our backyards to our front porches. I saw a father throwing a ball to his son in the middle of the day. People out walking, waving, and saying hello from that safe physical distance. People are sewing masks for healthcare workers. Caring for people they'll never meet. Undoubtedly, this disruption will help us develop new ways of being the church. Online offerings, so many resources for practicing daily prayer and devotion. Maybe our inability to be together physically for a while will bring us closer together spiritually as we pray for each other, for our leaders, for healthcare workers, for those who are ill and have lost jobs. And as we pick up the phone, to call the person who usually sits in the pew ahead of us, or the elderly neighbor who lives alone. This disruption might help us to appreciate the little things, the small gestures, and to live more fully in the moment and not be so busy planning and scheduling and worrying about the next thing. The disruption opening the way for something new or for something good to be reborn. There was a wonderful piece in the New York Times written by Tim Parker entitled, "This is Life Under Lockdown in Milan, Italy." Perhaps you read it or heard our presiding bishop quote it, but it bears repeating. Tim Parker says, "In just 2 weeks, all the usual certainties have gone. It's been a spiritual exercise in letting go. You paid for a season ticket on the subway. Now you realize subway travel is the surest way of getting the disease. You have a subscription to the gym. The gym is closed. So is the cinema. Your tickets for concerts and soccer games are useless. Your children can't go to school or university. Even mass is canceled. Everybody is being asked to think, not for themselves, but also for the community. Milan is a fragmented city. There are all kinds of ethnic groups, Chinese, Arabs, Hispanics, Filipinos, Indians, any number of Romanians and Slavs, Italians from every region. But inevitably, this virus is bringing on new awareness, an awareness that we all share the same physical space. Milan, Italy. We really live here. We sink or swim together. Perhaps we may even get to know each other, albeit without shaking hands. Maybe there is a new spirit of unity. Jesus talked to Nicodemus about rebirth and new life after disrupting Nicodemus's world. Let us see the disruption of physical distancing as an opportunity for new things to emerge in our lives, new patterns and priorities, a new spirit of unity. David Haas has put out a wonderful piece. I'll leave you with this. He says, so much has been and will continue to be for some time canceled. Sports events, concerts, plays, worship services, rallies, travel, meetings, classes, family gatherings, so much more. However, love has not been canceled. Mercy has not been canceled. Prayer has not been canceled. Attentiveness has not been canceled. Goodness has not been canceled. Thanksgiving has not been canceled. Loving relationships have not been canceled. Kindness has not been canceled. Music has not been canceled. Conversations have not been canceled. Learning has not been canceled. Poetry and storytelling has not been canceled. Courage has not been canceled. Meditation and contemplation have not been canceled. Painting and dancing has not been canceled. Families have not been canceled. Community and solidarity has not been canceled. Faith has not been canceled. Hope has not been canceled. And God's presence with us has not been canceled. I pray that you will know God's presence, goodness, and love, and be an agent of these things in the midst of all the disruptions. Amen.
I invite you to stand and to repeat with me the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty.
For us and for our salvation, he came down to heaven. Father,
Turning to our gracious and merciful God, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Lord Jesus Christ, just like Nicodemus, we come to you with many questions and doubts. Calm our fears as we try to make sense of what lays ahead, and grant us assurance that in you we may find freedom from condemnation and the promise of eternal life. In your mercy, O God.
Hear our prayer.
In these days of social distance, draw us closer around the promise that you are with us always. Hold the cross of Christ before us, and let it lead us with confidence into an unsure future. Keep the leaders of the church in your care and give them energy to continue to make Jesus known in new ways to a world in such great need. Strengthen all of us to be faithful witnesses in our service to you. In your mercy, O God.
Hear our prayer.
Heal those who are sick with any disease of mind, body, or spirit. We pray especially for those who are fearful or vulnerable to the COVID-19 virus. Quiet our troubled hearts at the enormity of this outbreak, and remind us that in you alone we can find peace. Today we pray especially for Bobby C., who was added to our prayer list this week. We pray for those who lack nourishing food, clean water, and warm shelter. Reveal to us those whom you would have us serve, and grant us a willing spirit to carry out our ministry with a joyful heart. In your mercy, O God,
hear our prayer.
Creator God, you fashioned us out of the dust of the earth. Make us faithful stewards of this amazing planet as we raise songs of praise to you for its bountiful resources. As you shower your love upon us, let us be as generous in our love for creation, that it will continue to sustain abundant life for generations to come. In your mercy, O God,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Son of God, you promised that those who believe will not perish, but have eternal life. Let your loving arms of mercy surround those who have finished the race and now rest from their labors. We give you thanks for the lives of Barbara Bell Gunderson and Janet Stromquist, in whose memory the flowers on the altar are given. May their faith provide direction to our journey, which begins and ends in you. In your mercy, O God,
hear our prayer.
We pause to allow you to add your own prayers, either silently or aloud. For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart,
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of God be always with you. Using safe physical distancing practices, let us offer to one another a sign of God's peace. Welcome again, everyone. I'll move over here to the middle. Coming up, we will have a virtual coffee hour following this service. Please tune in. There are links on Facebook and on Zoom, and those are on the website for you to tune in for virtual coffee hour after this service. A little lineup for this week. On Monday, I'll have a message at 9 a.m. On Tuesday, I'll be having Bible study at 9 a.m. On Wednesday, there's morning prayer at 9 a.m. Thursday, there's Compline at 9 p.m. On Friday, we're having music. We're calling it St. Paul Sings at 9 a.m. On Saturday, there will be a message with ways that we can continue to serve others. And then, of course, next Sunday, we'll have our online worship and coffee hour. And all of these can be found either through the email that you received or on the website. You can find links to all of these events coming up this week. Please let us know if you need anything. We have people who stand ready to make deliveries, so please contact the office or send us an email or fill out the form that's on the website. We have some resources down in the Grace Salon Road entry. That door is open in the morning. You can get into the entryway. We have prayer books and hymnals and other resources for kids and families down in the Grace Lawn Road entryway. A few of the ways that we can continue to serve: you can sign up to provide a meal for Loaves and Fishes in the middle of their kitchen remodeling. There's a sign-up genius on the website. Of course, this is Food Share Month, so the Chum Food Shelf can continue to use your donations. And sewers, as I mentioned in my sermon, sewers have been making masks for healthcare folks, and you can find out more about that by contacting Sue. Above all, let's be good to one another and pray for each other. It is our custom to have birthdays and anniversaries. Folks come up for a blessing. I would invite you during the week to send those in, and I'll mention folks by name who are celebrating a birthday or an anniversary, and then we'll have our prayer. This week, I am happy to announce that Mark and Sue Brown are celebrating their 45th wedding anniversary, and that is today. So happy anniversary to Mark and Sue Brown. Send your birthdays and anniversaries along, and I will mention you and we'll pray for you by name each Sunday. And we all need a little bit of good news, certainly, in the midst of it all. I am happy to report that Gene Manthe has a brand new great-grandson. Little Lucas Anthony is the son of Sherry and Adam Kuchek. Sherry is Barb Ammerman's daughter. And so we extend our congratulations to Sherry and Adam and to Gene. And it is a marvelous, marvelous reminder, little Lucas Anthony, that life goes on. Let us, with gladness, present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord.
God so loved the world, God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, we may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. To share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
The gifts of God for the people of God. During this time of not being able to receive communion sacramentally, I invite you to pray the prayer that's printed in the bulletin for making a spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Bless the God who calls us together.
Praise to God who makes us one people.
Blessed be God who has forgiven our sins.
Praise to God who gives hope and freedom.
Blessed be God whose word is proclaimed.
Praise to God who is revealed as love.
Blessed be God who alone has called us.
Therefore we offer all that we are and all that we shall become.
Accept, O God, our sacrifice of praise.
Accept our thanks for all you have done. Our hands were empty, and you filled them.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you. Remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.